Saint Jerome, confessor and doctor of the Church, pray for us. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. The great Catholic novelist of the last century, Evelyn Waugh, an English convert to the Holy Faith, was a bit of a curmudgeon, rather unpleasant man, actually, in his speech and conversation very often. Sometimes he was downright rude. One time at a dinner party, he insulted a lady, and the lady who was Church of England, she was a Protestant, said to him, she said, "Evelyn, and you're a Catholic." And Evelyn Waugh's response was, "Madam, imagine how much worse I would be if I were not a Catholic." That sums up some people, doesn't it? Because unless we had that help of the Catholic faith, my goodness, who knows to what depths we would descend. Now, I wouldn't say that's exactly the case of St. Jerome, but all the authors say he was a bit of a curmudgeon. That is to say, he did and said the right thing, but sometimes in the most unpleasant way possible. I've known some priests or even bishops like that, I suppose, in the traditional movement of the last 30 or 40 years. He even quarreled with St. Augustine. If you disagreed with him or weren't quite on the same page as he had no time for you and no patience. And yet, Almighty God raised him up to be the great defender of Catholic truth and orthodoxy. He spent himself for years in the desert doing everything necessary so that he could give Holy Mother Church a pure and a true Latin translation of the sacred scripture called the Vulgate, even going so far as to sit down with rabbis as a student so that he could learn all the intricacies of Aramaic and of Hebrew and render the proper and the correct translation. One of his particular glories is, when we think of it on the eve of Our Lady's Rosary Month, is that he vindicated and fearlessly opposed anyone who denied the perpetual virginity of the Mother of God, a virgin before he taught, and a virgin during, and a virgin after she gave birth to our blessed Savior. St. Jerome was born in Dalmatia, Croatia, and went to Rome as a young man to study, and hung with a wild crowd, as often young people do during their college years. And then he had the grace to convert, and he was baptized. But he still continued, because it was considered the thing to do, the study of the pagan authors, the Greek and the Roman pagans. And one time he had a dream. He got very sick, and he had a dream that he died, and he went to see St. Peter about getting into heaven. And St. Peter asked him who he was, and he said, "I'm a Christian." And St. Peter said, "No, you're not. You're a follower of Cicero. You're not a follower of Christ." And then after that, he decided to concentrate exclusively on the study of God's word, not the word of pagan writers, sacred scripture. And that led him to his great vocation and, as I say, indeed, to his very great glory. While he was a little bit ruthless and rude with his opponents and sometimes even with his friends, St. Jerome did have a soft side. You see it in the picture of St. Jerome. He's dressed as a cardinal because he was an assistant to Pope St. Damasus, although actually that's an anachronism. This was before the cardinals were instituted. But you see, he's got a lion with him, and the lion has sort of got his paws up on his ratchet. And the story is, of course, that he pulled a thorn out of the lion's paw, and then the lion stayed with him. They probably had similar personalities, and they got along, and so he told the lion to take care of his donkey for him. So he was good with animals, and he was also good with women. At that era, most priests, and it's often the case throughout church history, had not too much use for women and for their spiritual direction and guidance. But he had all of the time that was necessary, and he encouraged several of the wealthy women of Rome and gave them spiritual guidance so they could actually mount to the heights of sanctity. And last of all, towards the end of his life, he laid aside all of his studies. You know, he lived in Bethlehem, a monastery there, and he actually lived in a cave or a grotto, I thought, which was right next to, in the same cavern, as the grotto of Our Lord's Nativity. Well, towards the end of his life, Rome was invaded by the barbarians and fell for the first time, and a lot of Romans, not knowing where to go, got on a boat and came to the Holy Land, to Jerusalem. And when he saw all these poor refugees who have nothing, as refugees never do have anything, he said, it's time to give up the study of the scripture for the application of the scripture. And so he laid aside his studies and did everything possible to organize relief, beds and food and clothing for these poor refugees that had come to the Holy Land to seek a place to stay. The great saints say, ignorance of scripture is ignorance of Christ. The Novus Ordo makes a big deal about scripture and the study of scripture, but it's all for the purpose of perverting it and using perverted scripture as a means of promoting their new Gnostic one world religion. Let us love the word of God. Let us be careful to read at least some of it with reverence and respect each day, and if possible, to meditate upon it at least a little bit, knowing that as we read the Word of God, the Holy Ghost often will speak to us. It might even just be in a little pericope, maybe in the epistle or a gospel, in your daily missal. Try to live in the spirit of the church and to read those texts every day. But most of all, not just to study and to read, most of all to practice that. And think sometimes in your humility, if I weren't a Catholic, just how bad I'd probably be. God bless you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen.